My guest today really needs no introduction. He knows more about protein than you and I will ever possibly hope to know, but he is here today to bestow all of this knowledge as much as he can with us here today. He's also going to be speaking at the Fairfax Veg Fest on Sunday, April 24th in beautiful Herndon, Virginia. With that, we welcome the one and only Dr. T. Colin Campbell to the show. Sir, thank you so very much for being here.
Thank you. It's a pleasure indeed.
Let me ask you kind of a loaded question right out of the gate. And that question is, if you could rate the quality or the value of animal protein on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being the highest value and 1 being the lowest, what grade or what number would you give that?
Animal protein as a group of proteins in animals are more or less the same. I'd give it about between 8 and 10 for the different animal proteins.
And what about in terms of rating it for human health, then? How would that number shift on the scale of 1 to 10?
Something between 0 and 1.
There we go. And I think that people would be surprised to know that you didn't always necessarily realize that. It was only along your professional career and the research that you were doing that you kind of really reached the conclusion that, yeah, this is really something that humans should be avoiding.
Absolutely. I started up my career on a farm that was consistent with that belief of believing in animal protein. And then discovering fairly early in my career that that wasn't necessarily true. So it led to a lengthy career and lots of people and examining that question. Is it really true that animal protein is as high quality as what we maintain it is? That was the question.
And let's talk about, let's keep this in the context of human health and how much or how little there is benefit to consuming animal protein as a human. Let's talk about the quality there in terms of animal protein and plant protein for human consumption. Which gives the bigger protein boost? And then we can talk about the different health benefits and health detriments that come with them.
Okay, so animal protein is generally regarded, has been for a long time, is high quality. And what that means in a technical sense is that of the protein being consumed at some moment in time, the proteins that has the highest proportion of the protein being retained by the body for doing good things, that's considered high quality. In other words, it's just a very simple little determination in a test situation of the protein we consume. If we can retain more, that's a good deal. That's high quality. And all the animal proteins tend to have that property. There's some variation among them, but they're all higher than all the plant proteins. So that's quite a, but it turns out retaining more protein, which most people aren't aware of, that's the way we do it. That's why it's high quality. It sounds good. That initially was for the purpose of growing animals faster. And sure enough, more protein causes animals to grow faster, which in the case of animal production and that sort of thing on the farm, it's a good deal. Somehow that got translated for humans in a sense that higher protein, higher quality protein might make us grow faster when we're young. And yes, maybe it does a little bit, but it's hardly noticeable, but nonetheless, it's probably true. That's not necessarily the best way to grow up because when you grow faster, it raises the risk for especially in women, raise the risk for a higher risk for breast cancer, uterine cancer, among other things. So, and it turns on the synthesis of blood cholesterol, which is associated with heart disease. So the so-called high quality protein, we shouldn't call it high quality. It is only for the purpose of growing animals faster, but not for creating human health, no way.
So let's talk about that. Have you heard of any plant proteins that would then lead to cancer, as animal proteins have been linked to do, triggering high cholesterol in people, as animal proteins have been known to do? How do the detriments of plant protein compare to those of animal protein, if there are any?
Well, the plant proteins, I know of no evidence, and I'm pretty certain of this statement. I know no plant proteins that actually turn on cholesterol increase in cholesterol and turn on cancer and heart disease and that kind of thing. They just don't. But, you know, at the same time, I need to point out one little bit of caveat here in a sense. When we talk about how much protein we're consuming or the kind of protein we consume, remember, we're talking about whole food. And then, so in that set of setting, as we consume more animal protein, we tend to consume less plant protein or more animal foods, less plant foods. That generates quite a number of changes that participate in this relationship, all to the good if we go to plants. So,
and I also want to ask you about kind of the effect that if we were to shift toward a more plant predominant or completely plant-based diet, what do you estimate the effect would be on the rates of cancer throughout this country and then worldwide?
Well, if we compare countries, which has been done for a number of different diseases, it turns out that we see a straight line relationship from almost no animal protein consumption or animal food consumption up to, say, fairly high levels like we do in the West. And when you do it that way, it turns out there's a straight line relationship right down to the point of zero animal protein intake, in which case then the diseases are at their lowest. So as soon as we make that kind of comparison, as soon as society start putting animal protein into their diet, lots of things begin to change. That's when these diseases like cancer and heart disease and some other chronic kidney disease, that's when they all start to increase right from the lowest level. So it's my thought, my interpretation, that we don't need animal protein for anything. In fact, if anything, it's only going to generate some harm straight off.
To that end, what then would the effect be on the pharmaceutical industry should we all shift toward a more plant-based diet?
Great question. We get health from eating plants. And so if we eat the animal protein-based foods, that's where we get the sickness. That's where heart disease, cancer, and all that sort of thing occurs. And so for some reason, that's what we've done. Most of us, we consume more and more animal foods, thinking that's a good health when in fact it's not. It creates more disease conditions, which account for most of the healthcare cost bill. And much of the healthcare cost bill really has to do with use of pharmaceuticals. So on the one hand, we're sort of consuming the food that makes us sick. And then in turn, really, I'm sort of expecting, oh, that's okay. We'll get that taken care of. We've got some drugs. So we end up using drugs as a solution to our messing around with the wrong food. So it makes a really big deal. I mean, I think if we were to use nutrition the right way, consume the right food, and not get sick, not nearly at the level we do, reduce it maybe 80, 90% at least, we would have much less use for pharmaceuticals.
That's a huge number, 80 to 90%. I mean, I'm sure that there are people that really just stood up and it's certainly those who are working in that industry. I'm sure that they may have even just gotten some chills down their spine.
Yeah, unfortunately, I guess, I don't know. I mean, I was in pharmacology, so I know that community quite well, and I published most of my papers in that community. So yeah, that idea is the purpose of that sort of effort is to create drugs to take care of our sickness. When I suddenly learned over time that why do we have to get sick? You know, is there a way to keep us from getting sick? And of course, that's nutrition. So the healthier we are by consuming, let's say, plant-based diet, then we need less and less drugs to treat the illness that we otherwise get. 80-90%, yeah, that's a big number.
So let me ask you this then. What would your message be to somebody, and I hear from people who watch the show all the time, and they say, well, listen, Chuck, you know, my grandmother, my grandfather, they lived to be 90 years old, and they ate a steak every day, they smoked a pack of Marlboros every day, they ate bacon for breakfast every morning, and they still lived to this ripe old age. To me, that seems like that would be the exception rather than the rule. But as somebody who's really devoted their career and their life to doing this type of research on proteins, I mean, what would your message be to that person?
Well, it's about the same as people who smoke all their lives and get lived to be 90 and 95. and about 5% of those people actually survived until that long. They're paying some consequences, but they say, I got here because I was smoking. It was a crazy idea. We have to remember that most people, you know, would suffer the consequences of smoking like that. The same thing with animal protein. So in science, it's one of the things we just have to live with. There are always going to be some exceptions. But in this particular case, the number of exceptions that are able to survive on the wrong diet or survive on using cigarettes or whatever the case may be, doing the wrong thing, that percentage is very low. And if we study it a little more carefully, I think that we could find out the uniqueness of that small number of people. Maybe they have better genes, possibly, give them a little more strength to, you know, coming out of the gate, so to speak. Or maybe they are doing some other things that, you know, might help them out. So we can always talk about that. But yeah, there's going to be exceptions, but the rule is far greater than the exception.
And really, I don't think that many people would argue with that. I mean, how many people do you know who live to be 95 years old and are smoking a pack of cigarettes a day? You know, it's very few. I want to ask you about the World Health Organization's classification of red and processed meat. We know that those are carcinogenic. Obviously, those are animal proteins. But in your estimation, should other animal proteins be lumped into that same level of classification?
Yes, definitely. The WHO, who came up with that information in the beginning, they made a distinction between just, let's say, fresh animal food as opposed to processed. And actually, the fresh, they were analyzing data in a very, very crude way, I must tell you. It turned out the processed meats were a little more problematic than the regular meats. And so they were both bad, if you will. The process, there was some indication it was a little worse. That got the headlines, and I'm really convinced because I've worked with that organization. That really was a way out of the mess. We didn't have to talk too much about just eating meat. It was a kind of an excuse. Oh, yeah, let's not eat the processed meats, which we most of the time, most people don't know what a processed meat really is and what's the basis for its effect. And so the real message should have been, Let's cut out all animal foods, processed or otherwise.
But. So let me just clarify here. So we're talking about a lot of people view a lean meat, like a just chicken breast by itself, as a health food. But in your estimation, that's right on par with that red steak or that hot dog that the WHO has been talking about.
Of course. I don't see really any major difference at all. I mean, we might, you know, look very in some details and here and there, scientists will find this or that or something else and then make headlines out of it occasionally. But broadly speaking, it's all the same.
And the same would go for the protein found in eggs and in dairy products as well?
Yes, definitely.
Okay. The other question that we get from time to time, we have about 5 minutes left here. The other question that we get from time to time is, well, what about complete proteins? They say, well, look, you know, I'm interested in eating a little bit healthier, but I'm worried that if I take meat or dairy out of my diet, I'm not going to get a complete protein. Is it possible for somebody to get all of the proteins, the various kinds of protein that they need, while still eating a plant-based diet and not have to worry about missing out on one amino acid or another?
Absolutely. Quick answer. Yes, we can get all the protein we need from plant-based foods. Each of them have somewhat different compositions of so-called amino acids, but when you combine them, as we do in a normal setting, we're getting all the amino acids we need, all the so-called good quality protein. We don't need to have it all in just one food source like meat.
So basically nothing to worry about there.
Nothing, absolutely nothing. That is kind of a misnomer in a sense.
Let's talk about a specific type of protein here. As the plant-based movement has been growing, you go to the grocery store, you look in the frozen food aisle, and you just see this explosion of frozen plant-based offerings. And if you flip over the package, you look at the ingredients label, a lot of times you'll see something called a protein isolate. What is a protein isolate, and is that something that you would consider to be healthy, or is that something that we should really look to be avoiding?
Well, as way I see it, it's kind of a mixed bag in that industry at the moment. Some people are isolating protein, if you will, whey protein, casein by itself, that sort of stuff is being added to food. That's an isolate, that's away from the normal food itself. But some of that that industry is moving forward by just simply synthesizing proteins, you know, from a, we call it a nucleic acid template, and, you know, in a vat or something like that. They're synthesizing proteins that have the same composition of animal foods because they're enamored with the idea of making high-quality animal protein. That's not necessary. In fact, that's accomplishing nothing when they do that. Others are using protein, whether they call it isolates or not, I don't know, but they're using protein from plants, especially from soy and legume proteins. And so I guess someone would call it isolate, I guess, if you isolate it out. But on the other hand, if you use the whole food to get that protein, we're in good shape.
I think the majority of listeners of this show are trying to gravitate toward a whole food plant-based diet. And when we talk about, again, getting all of those complete proteins, a lot of the advice that's been given with various experts on this show has been to eat a wide variety of fruits and vegetables, beans, grains, all of the above. Sounds to me like that is the best way to go. Would you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm all in with that. That's absolutely.
I like that terminology, all in. I say that all the time. I love it. Two more quick ones for you. You talk a lot about this reductionist view of nutrition that we have by and large as a society. So when you talk about the reductionist view, what do you mean by that? And where are we going wrong with that?
Well, you know, we tend to think the reductionist view is focusing on one detail at a time. We tend to think as far as the causation of disease is concerned in regarding food, it's one nutrient, you know, operating through one mechanism that lends itself to pharmaceutical intervention, maybe to produce one disease. That is the modern medical system, and I'm totally opposed to that philosophy. When you take things out of context, we should be thinking more about the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. And we got lots of evidence to really demonstrate that in, that idea in spades. So when nutrients are in food, they do their good thing if it's the right kind of food. If we take it out and put it someplace else in a pill or something like that, we cannot expect them to get the same effect. And so what we need to do is to consume whole foods as much as possible.
And then the last one that I have for you, sir, again, thank you so much for your time today, is that we'll also hear from people who say, well, look, you know, I'm going to continue to eat steak. I'm going to continue to eat chicken. I'm going to continue to eat fish. But what I'm going to do is limit my exposure to the sun, and I'm going to exercise, both of which have been proven to reduce the risk of chronic disease, specifically cancer. In terms of comparing the other steps that a person can take to lower the risk of developing cancer, how would you rank nutrition there?
I would rank nutrition very, very high. I don't know, I can't put a number on it, but I would put it in the neighborhood of at least 80 to 90% of the total effect that you can achieve. Exercise, yes, is good. There's no question about that. And an interesting thing about it, exercising with a good diet at the same time, that's where you get the big bang for the buck. The same with sunshine. We need sunshine. To get synthesis of vitamin D and so forth. So a combination of sunshine, adequate water is very important, and exercise and good food. That's the whole package. And we can't do much better than that.
There you go. That's the secret to it all. Dr. T. Colin Campbell, again, going to be at the Fairfax Veg Fest Sunday, April 24th. Visit fairfaxvegfest.org for tickets and information. Thank you so very much for your time, my friend. I greatly appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. Appreciate that too.
If your health IQ is a couple of points higher than it was a few minutes ago, go ahead and like this video or subscribe to the YouTube channel. And to take it even higher, head over to Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your favorite shows. Look for The Exam Room by the Physicians Committee. Hit the subscribe button there as well and help to make your world a healthier place.